fake news, China deal falling apart, and markets have made a top. What's up, everybody? Welcome aboard to Bubba's Bottom Line. It is Sunday, May the 12th. Happy Mother's Day to everybody out there. And, you know, a lot of things are going on out there. And, of course, the big story of last week was the tweeting over the weekend by the president and the collapsing of the markets overnight last Sunday. And almost every day we're much lower, ended up closing higher. And we'll cover that when we get to our look at the markets. But in the meantime, the markets appear to have put tops in. But a lot of things are going on out there. And of course, when we look at the potential China deal and what's happening with China, you know, again, is the deal actually falling apart? Are we playing hardball? There's a lot going on within this deal. And of course, I think the key is the economic power and the ability to keep China without taking advantage of our system and without stealing our intellectual properties. Now we know, okay, that all nations steal intellectual properties, okay? We do, they all do, okay? The difference is that when you go to China, they make you give them to them. It's not like you're stealing them, they're making you hand them over. You know, so we'll see if this eventually gets played out. Obviously, we can see that China needs the deal a lot more than we do. And of course, we can continue to hear them talk about this tax that will be on Americans because of this. Well, you don't think that China will not continue to reduce and manipulate their currency to overcome the tariffs? I mean, I think that's one thing that we're, again, one of the things we look at when we have a central banking system and the ability to manipulate currency is the ability to bring the currency cheap enough to overcome the other costs. So again, there's a lot going on here. I still believe and still say there will be a deal at some point, but if there's not, I don't think that it's the end of the world. I don't think that this is a major issue. I think that this goes back to the same thing that we have said, is that China needs us more than we need them. And I know that we're hearing a lot of information out there about what's going to happen and how it's going to work. And to me, it really looks like, however, the two presidents can figure out how to come out and claim victory, I think that will be the end of the story. And I think this is more of a deal making, like in any other kind of deal. So we'll see how this indeed does play out. But you can see by the markets, okay, that they didn't collapse. I mean, we're still within a couple percent of all-time highs, but we do think that the tops have been put in. I think there's a lot of things that we're looking at, and of course, one thing that I got into it last week with a couple of the shows I was on was the wage inflation. Now, we don't actually think that the companies are not going to pass on the higher wages they're paying to the consumer. Okay. Now, again, everybody says, no, they won't pay. Well, what do you think they're going to do? This is how we got in the problem in the begin with, was that when things got bad, they cut wages and they basically told their employees, okay, you want to work harder for less money. Well, now the employees hold the upper hand. So you don't think that major conglomerates and major companies are going to eat the cost of payroll. They're going to pass the cost on to the consumer. Do we think this is different? Okay, it's the same as their tariff costs. Do you think they're not going to pass the tariff costs on if there is indeed these massive tariffs that we continue to hear about? I mean, the effect on GDP will be fractional, okay? The actual true effect will be fractional. I know we want to make it a big deal, okay? Because what that really does is it allows Walmart and it allows all the other companies that do a lot of work with China to raise their prices and raise their profit margins, okay? Again, let's not kid each other, okay, that this doesn't happen all the time, that every excuse to raise price to increase profit does not get taken advantage of, all right? It goes same with the oil companies, same with Starbucks. Again, Coffee is on about 8-year lows right now. Has the cost of coffee, of a cup of coffee, come down at a Starbucks? And of course the answer is no. So inflation is coming, all right? We can try to watch the ridiculous Fed models about inflation and how we're not seeing the inflation, but we are paying more for goods and services, okay? We are paying more for everything. The only thing we're not paying more for is things you buy every 20 years, right? So to me, that's a crock. So inflation is coming, all right? Whether they want to put it in there or not, we had CPI and PPI last week, no inflation. Okay, well, there's no inflation. In the meantime, I'm paying more for what I get every day. To me, that's inflation. It's pretty simple. And with higher wages, okay, those costs are going to be passed down to me as well, okay? So I think that to not think that we'll have inflation is somewhat laughable. And I think what else is laughable is listening to some of the pundits out there. And you know, again, they want to make such a big deal out of the trade wars, okay? Obviously, I guess they want to report news. They want to sell newspapers. They want to sell airtime, whatever. But, and again, I am not a hog farmer. I can't speak directly for hog farmers, but I saw a couple on air that were saying, oh my God, the deal is, we need the deal so bad. And I looked, and I went and looked back, and I see, other than a four-month period in 2014, hogs are at the highest prices they've ever been, okay? So when something's at the highest price it's ever been, how can the China trade wars be affecting it, okay? That, again, maybe I don't get it, but tell me, okay, the price, the futures price are the highest they've been since the PED virus in 2014, okay, in all time. So tell me, explain to me how these trade wars are having a dramatic effect, especially because one of the biggest hog producers is Smithfield's, which is a Chinese company that is based here. So again, I look at it and I go, okay, so where is the issue? Now I can see what's going on in the grain markets and how it has some effect. But again, a lot of the effect is, unfortunately, the efficiency of farming, the efficiency at how we produce so much excess goods, okay? We're right now, we're producing with no event more that can be consumed, okay? So that shows one of the reasons. You know, we can go back to a simple supply-demand model versus looking at anything else. So again, I think that we're making far too much out of these trade wars. And certainly, if you think I'm wrong, please send me in a comment. I have no issue with saying I'm wrong if I'm wrong on this. But again, from the standpoint that I look at it, okay, you know, we have this overdramatic supply, which is obviously is going to happen when you get a glut. It was the same thing that happened in oil when it went way down. So obviously these things take time to work their way through a system, and eventually I think that it will work its way through the system and we'll get back to some normalcy and some movement. But again, it's going to take some sort of event, which we have not had, to disrupt an oversupplied market, okay? In the meantime, China car sales tanked again, down 16%, okay? So they've now fallen 11 months in a row, okay? And now does that have to do with tariffs as well? So, you know, we want to blame everything on tariffs. How about it's an economic slowdown? How about that there's troubles globally everywhere with the economy? How about you put so much free money into the system and so much debt that it's now starting to come? How about that maybe we've started a recession already? Of course, we know that nobody will ever be able to say, and I can't say with 100% certainty, but certainly nobody knows when the next recession is going to start, but I think it's already started. You know, I'm not going to wait for the Fed from 10 years later to tell me that, well, 2019 was a recession. I'm saying that I believe that we've seen the start of it already, okay? You know, and I think one of the things, you know, when you have all these issues of all this massive spending and this massive debt, it creates problems. And of course, the whole, I look at it that the China talk is really more about trying to get the budget redone, and it's just a ploy to bleed the taxpayers once again. you know, we, the taxpayers, are always at the brunt of all the troubles. It's, they want to get to us so they can get that money to keep that big, big budget going. Okay. Now, why is it that we just can't cut back, okay, and get back to balancing the budget and have to make some strict cutbacks across versus the continuation of building more debt, okay? Again, I don't like the building of more debt, and I see what the administration is doing now. Not a big fan of adding more debt. Of course, they've all done it from way back when to now. I mean, this is not, you know, we didn't get $22 trillion in debt this year. And of course, the bigger the number, the more it magnifies, okay? So the bigger issue that we have to deal with. And again, so it's the same as the market, right? You know, they continue to talk about how fast we went from, you know, 25,000 to 26,000, the fastest ever. Well, it's a lot easier when you're only going up 4% than when you went from 1,000 to 2,000, you had to go up 100%, okay? So let's not let the numbers get in the way of the facts, okay? That the debt rolling up right now, just on interest alone, okay, is astronomical because of the size of the number. So it's a lot easier for it to go up a lot faster based on size only, okay? You know, I love the way that the left, who has just come out with an unveiling, a new policy to relieve college debt, okay? Now, if they're going to do it, I hope I can get a refund for the $500,000 I paid for two kids to go to two big schools, okay? So maybe I can get my money back because, you know, with student debt, you can't write off your taxes, you can't do anything with it. It's like throwing money down a drain, okay? So again, this is such a joke, okay? This is so ridiculous and so anti what the system is about to create all this and now want to give it back. And of course, we want to give it back. Why? Well, it must be getting closer to voting season for Sleepy Joe and for, you know, for Crazy Bernie and all these others. Okay. Again, I gotta love the names the president comes up with. And of course, Pete Buttigieg or whatever his name is, America is not, never was that great. I don't know. What are you doing here? Why didn't she go out with the rest that don't want to be here? Okay. You know, we want to continue to criticize what we have here. And again, I'm certainly giving what I think are some of the issues, but there is no place like the United States of America, okay? And of course, if we didn't have all this ridiculous political posturing, we'd certainly probably be in a hell of a lot better shape. But when you continue to have the left in this case, and again, it's not always the left, in this case it's the left, continuing to want to go for either impeachment or for to cut, get in the way, instead of working together and moving forward, okay, we are moving backward because, of course, right now, again, the people on the left want to create this illusion of all the illegalities that President Trump did or didn't do. Now, again, one thing I think that we all know, okay, is that if anything was really out there, if there was a there, we would probably know about it by now, don't you think? But of course, nobody wants to go back to talk about Hillary Clinton and all the laws she broke, or her husband, or again, both sides of the aisle, all the way back into history. But the idea is to move forward and make things better instead of trying to move backwards. In the meantime, this is Bubba's Bottom Line, Todd Bubba Horowitz. It is Sunday, May the 12th, Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day. And of course, we're offering for one more weekend. If you'd like to check out our webinars on hedging and on futures, you can email me at bubba@bubbatrading.com. I certainly like to sign up to you if you want them. They're free. Okay. So just email me at bubba@bubbatrading.com. And of course, if you want to help us out with the high school program, go to Patreon, patreon.com/BubbaTrading. That's patreon.com/BubbaTrading. Now let's get back to Bubba's Bottom Line with me. Welcome back to Bubba's Bottom Line. Todd Bubba Horowitz with you. And of course, we did have a fairly wild week in the markets. And of course, we did call a top during the week. Had some very specific things that we were expecting to happen, and they did happen. So we are now on the side of the sellers. Okay. We're just not going to sell the market. Now, again, one of the things you got to remember about markets is we're just not sellers to sell. Okay. You want to look for levels to sell the market. Okay. You want to look for opportunities that the markets make it back to, let's say, a resistance level to where you want to sell. But you saw some very interesting things last week. What you saw was the markets got punished every day, rallied late, but until Friday, they made lower highs and lower lows each and every day. Okay. Now, a Friday may have been an anomaly. Maybe we're going to be wrong. Maybe the market's going to turn around. But for now, we're sellers of the markets, and we're sellers of the Dow just over 26,000. We're sellers of the S&P over 2880. Okay, because that's what the markets are telling us today, is that we can be and should be sellers. Okay, that's what we can see based on the work that we do. Again, that can change, right? We can reverse it out and take our losses and move forward. But right now, the way it looks, we've been long since the beginning of January, okay? And now we're now getting ready to get short, and we've gotten short in our portfolios. So, and now we will look to add by selling rallies. In the meantime, oil had to move down, came down to our first level, our first test of 60, bounced back up again. So now the next time down, we're looking for oil to break below, okay, 60 and go to about 58. I would think we'll see that, you know, in the next couple of weeks, maybe sooner. Again, we think that oil is a oversupplied commodity and has been a benefit of things that it shouldn't have been. And I think once we start to see some of this hectic stuff take place, and you might get some resolve in Venezuela, that would also free up some supply. So again, we're looking to be sellers of oil around the 63 to 64 level. And of course, gold continues to churn between that 1280 and 1290 level. And I think it was very interesting last Sunday night and during the week when the markets were under heavy pressure, okay, gold really never took off, which would be a sign to tell you that more than likely gold is still headed lower. We are now targeting, okay, the 1220 to 1240 level on the downside. We expect the next break from consolidation will be lower because, again, based on the information that we have in front of us, based on the footprint that we have to look at, it looks to us that gold is still headed lower, okay? So, and we've been short gold since about 1330, and we're looking for prices to fall lower. We're looking for the dollar to continue to go higher, okay? In fact, I talked about this on CNBC Asia on Thursday night, that the dollar, obviously very manipulated, but it's also a safe haven play, okay? You know, not only is gold a potential safe haven play, okay, which we don't agree it is, we just say gold is a hard asset commodity. However, the dollar and the treasury bonds are safe haven asset plays, and the dollar is up much closer to its high, and looks like it wants to go higher, and we are still looking for the dollar to go past par and believe that it will. And of course, the more issues, the more troubles that come about board out there, will create more fear, which will create more of a dollar buy, okay? That's one thing that we like to look at and understand, is that the fear doesn't only show up in the VIX, okay? Because of the option market, fear shows up in the dollar, fear shows up in the bond market. The bond market, okay, which again, for those of you who don't understand, bond futures go higher. It means interest rates are going lower. Bigger demand for bond futures typically means it's a fear play that people are looking to make sure they can save their money because the United States Treasury notes and the United States Treasury bonds are guaranteed by the full faith and credit of the United States government. What that's worth right now, I can't tell you, okay? But they are guaranteed by the full faith and credit. So the bonds have broken to the upside, okay? And we've had to reverse and look to be on the long side of bonds as much as it pains us, because I still believe that interest rates are going to go higher, not lower. But right now, based on the footprint, I cannot stand in the way of a market. As you know, we will take our losses when we are wrong and move on, okay? So we're moving on, all right? Again, it looks like for now, and again, if this chatter and this stuff continues and the markets continue to sell off, then you might see the Fed come in with one of their cuts. Now, again, I can't imagine it, you never know. Grain markets, as we talked about a little earlier, but they're ugly. Okay, again, we can blame the trade wars if we want, or we can actually look at what the actual facts are. And the facts are is that we have a dramatic oversupply. We have not had any any trouble with supply in years. Okay, even before this started. Okay, there was many that were looking. For example, there was many out there looking for $7 soybeans long ago, before the trade wars even started. All right. We do know that the hedge funds are pounding away, basing it on the trade. Okay, we do know that they're massively short right here. So again, we'll see how it plays out. You know, again, I think we'll see an event, and I don't know how much more bad news we can price into the grain markets, but they have been ugly. And of course, soybeans have been the ugliest. Now they've gone basically straight down, from higher levels, and it's been extremely challenging. And of course, obviously more challenging if you're a farmer and your planting costs and your input costs are more expensive than you can sell them for. But again, that's part of the business. And I think that resolves itself out. I think that you've got an overabundant amount of people selling into this market. And eventually that does turn. It's the same as we say, high prices cure high prices, low prices cure low prices. And at some point here, I think we'll get some red, but that's one of the reasons we always talk about hedging our grains so we don't have to worry about it. But we are long grains, okay, and we're looking for a rally, and we're looking for the hedge funds to get trapped, but they have had the pedal to the metal and continue to push lower, okay? Meats have been cattle, live cattle and feeders. They were down about 15 days in a row at one time. They finally had a little teeny little bounce on Friday. Again, is this going to be the bottom? That's hard to say. I would like to see these markets consolidate for a while before committing, or maybe I should be committed, but before committing that is the bottom. Now, we are long, unfortunately, but again, we're looking for this to go sideways for a while before we can actually make a dramatic commitment to want to add into our positions here, because the pattern is extremely ugly. And looks like it could continue to go lower until it doesn't. I mean, I think if you look at the three charts of soybeans, live cattle, and feeder cattle, basically they've gone parabolically down. Okay. Now, we know at some point there's going to be a bounce, but will the bounce be enough to turn them around and at least let them go sideways or flat or to the upside, or are they going to continue lower? That's the decision that you can't make ahead of time. That's the decision that the footprint of the market has to come out and show you, okay? So that's what we're watching for there. And of course, the hog markets, again, what happened to the African swine flu? You know, that was the big fear. And of course, as I said earlier, we are at prices that are, there's only 4 months where the prices were higher than they are today, okay? Which was in 04 and 14 when we had the PED virus. So again, I think they're trading in consolidation. I think you buy the bottom end, which is around 86, 87, and you sell the top end at around 100. I mean, I think that's the way, if you want to trade, that's the way you trade the hog markets right now. Again, I think that that's just the market. But you can see we had a monster rally, okay? And now we've been consolidating. So after the consolidation, we'll either break to the upside or we'll break back down again. Right now, it looks like they're going to churn. So we'll continue to watch as we see what goes on there. In the meantime, the cryptos, as we said, are now over, as of this morning, they're now over, the Bitcoin is now over 7,000. Okay, so if you remember, we were talking about it when it was 35 and 36 and 3700, that it looked like it was building a bottom. And here we are. Now, again, I'm not telling you we're going back to 20,000 tomorrow. I'm not saying we're going back to 5,000 tomorrow. I'm saying that watch the pattern, okay, and we'll continue to diagnose what we see based on the money flow. But it looks to me that the cryptos want to start to move their way back higher. I mean, they've already basically doubled in price since their lows. Okay, so you would expect from here potentially a little bit of a pullback. But again, and I'm not telling you to invest a lot here. I'm not telling you to invest anything. Okay, all I'm saying is that it is a space that I believe in. It's a space that I'm slightly involved in. But the money I do have involved, I am fully aware that it might go to zero. Okay, so let's be clear about there. Now, you know, I think one of the big things to watch, or the next domino that might fall in these trade wars, okay, is high yield debt. Okay, I think this is another issue. As we continue to chase yield, the demand and for junk bonds, the demand for that higher yield continues to grow, okay? And of course, again, that's always a recipe for disaster at some point. These are certain signs you see when markets are getting ready to end and reverse. And again, remember, we're a believer of the markets over time. They go up 8% year over year, just not every year. Okay. So again, and again, it could turn back and we could be wrong here. But again, the chase for high yield bonds, all of these things are warning signs that the fake news, the pundits refuse to acknowledge. They just love it. They just love the chirp. Markets are going higher, up every day, up. Oh, you got to love your 401k. And again, I'm not saying not to love it. It's all great. Okay. But at some point, you got to learn how to hedge or take protection. Okay. At some point, you got to put yourself in a position, okay, to make sure you understand what's going on. In the meantime, this is Bubba's Bottom Line. Todd Bubba Horowitz. We're going to step out here for a break and come back with my commentary right after the break. Bubba's Bottom Line. So everyone, again, remember, if you want to get my webinars, just email me at bubba@bubbatrading.com. Would love to share them with you. And again, I'm a big fan of hedging and helping everybody hedge, whether it be your farm or it be your equity portfolio. And of course, we do a lot with futures. So check us out. Email me at bubba@bubbatrading.com. I'll send you the webinars. And of course, don't forget about our high school program at Patreon, patreon.com/bubbatrading. That's patreon.com/bubbatrading. Let's get back to my commentary. Welcome back to Bubba's Bottom Line. Todd Bubba Horowitz. I've got a couple little commentaries here for you just to close out today. And Mother's Day, happy Mother's Day again. Number one is there's been a big stink about Jeopardy. Okay, great game, right? The Jeopardy champ, James Holzhauer. Oh, he continues to win money, setting records like crazy. And people are whining and complaining about the way he plays the game. Now, don't you have to answer the questions? No matter how you play the game, don't others try to do what he does just because he happens to be a professional gambler? And forget that he's a professional gambler. Just because he's got the cojones to jump out and make double up to get to those levels, okay? So that make him a bad guy? Does that mean he's ruining the Jeopardy game, okay? I don't get it. I wonder what's going on here with all this political correctness. He's ruining the game because he's won almost $2 million because he's the second winningest, I think 21 in a row, and coming back in a couple of weeks. Does that ruin the game because he's so good? Did Ken Jennings not ruin the game because he won 74 matches in a row? Again, you have to be awfully smart to get on there, and you have to go through all this whole process, and you have to be quick to answer the trigger, and you have to be quick to bet and do everything right. So we should fault the guy because he's fast, he's willing to gamble, and he's smart. Gee, let's penalize him for that instead, or let's support Bernie Sanders and Ocasio for saying that the banks get away with charging too much interest on credit cards. Okay, now nobody's forcing people to go out and borrow. We have usury rates here, okay? And those are the rates that has been developed by your Congress, okay? By your Senate, okay? They allowed it. You know, it used to be higher, okay? But again, I'm not a fan of usury rates. Those are loan shark rates. But I don't need that Bernie Sanders saying that, well, I have to loan somebody money at higher risk at a lower rate. All of these places are lending higher risk money at higher dollars. That's the way that it goes. And I don't have a problem with it. I do have a problem with the rates that are usury rates, but also people should know that sometimes maybe you shouldn't borrow. Maybe you shouldn't buy something you can't afford to buy. Okay. You know, again, it isn't typically spent on necessities. Okay. It's typically spent on something extra, the credit card. But if you want to eliminate credit cards in the hands of individuals for the case of emergency, then bring the rates much farther down. But again, this goes back to the people who want their peace from their lobbyists, okay? This is a whole big mess that we'll get into at some point, okay? But it's not just the rate here. And again, I'm not a fan. I don't want to see, you know, remember 24.9 or 29.9%. You know, all these little tricky gimmicks they have, okay? But the wrong guys are handling it for the wrong reasons, okay? And, of course, that will do it for today's Bubba's Bottom Line. Happy Mother's Day, everybody. Have a great weekend, and we'll see you back tomorrow with Bubba's Daily Update. Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there. I thank you. Have a great day. We'll see you later.